Wait, you have a TV?
No, I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide, you don't need a TV.
Hello, welcome to the very first episode of the TV Guidance Counselor podcast. First of all, I want to thank you for checking out the podcast. You may not have heard of me, so I appreciate you coming in to check it out. My name is Ken Reed. For those of you who don't know me, I am a Boston-based comedian and a huge television nerd. Growing up, TV was my absolute life. I had no friends and hardly any family aside from television. I want to give you a little bit of background on this podcast and tell you what it's about before we get into the heart of it. My guest this week will be comedian Mike Kaplan, who you've probably heard of as being comedian Mike Kaplan. He's quite famous. But before we get into that, let me tell you where this came from. Growing up, I used to very much look forward to every Wednesday when the TV guide would come in the mail. I would run to the mailbox, grab the TV guide, get a pen and paper and a highlighter, and then plan my week. Somewhat sad, yes. But it was what I did with my time, and I have fond memories of it. So over the years, I've collected many, many TV guides, amongst other things that I collect, but I have pretty much every TV guide from 1980 to about 1994 or 1995 or so. They are on display in my home in a large spinning rack. Everyone comments on them when they come into my house. And so alternatively, for years, I've wanted to do a podcast. People have asked me why I don't do a podcast, and one of the reasons was I didn't really have a good idea for one that would be different enough and representative enough of who I am and what I'm interested in, until about 6 months ago when a good friend and very funny comedian Sean Sullivan point blank suggested to me, he basically came up with the concept for this show. He said, "Hey Ken, you should," which is my name, he said, "Hey Ken, you should have someone over your house. They go through your TV guide collection, they pick a random TV guide, they sit down and they pick out what they would watch every night that week in prime time from 8 to 10 o'clock, and then the podcast is the two of you sitting down and discussing their choices." And that is exactly what this podcast is. Every week, every Wednesday, there'll be a new podcast up. I will have a new guest on. They will pick a random TV guide between 1980 and 1995, and we will sit down and go through the primetime lineups and their choices. We'll disagree. We'll agree sometimes. We'll go with my pick, which is usually the correct pick. We'll go with their pick. We'll get some insights into their growing up and what they watched on television, and I think you'll enjoy it, and I think it will be fun. So please enjoy the very first episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my good friend, Mr. Mike Kaplan. Hello and welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed, the TV Guidance Counselor, and I'm very pleased to have as my guest this week, Mr. Mike Kaplan. Mike, welcome.
Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. Welcome to my home.
I appreciate your hospitality.
You're welcome. Mike has been in my home before, so it's not that exciting for him.
I appreciate it again.
Yes, it's not as exciting for him as it is for some people who this is the first time they've been to the home.
Oh, yeah. It's an impressive home.
It's fairly impressive.
And the first floor bathroom.
First floor bathroom. We do have a Hawaii bathroom, so it's a Hawaii-themed bathroom. It has grass on the floor.
You actually went to Hawaii to take pictures of yourself.
Yes, just for the bathroom.
Yeah.
And I also had the bathroom shipped in from Hawaii. It's a bathroom that comes from Hawaii.
And there's one of those what's the eye goggle things that you
chick. It's a ViewMaster.
Yeah, there you
and
go.
The reels are 3D images of Hawaii. So if you're sitting on the toilet,
you're going to the bathroom in Hawaii.
In Hawaii, exactly. And that was what we were going for.
Yes.
So excellent. So Mike, you've picked a TV guide from the week of May 30th, 1992.
Yes.
So my first question for you is, what drew you to this particular TV guide?
Well, you have a lot of TV guides to choose from.
Really do.
And I wanted something from the early 90s, because that was sort of when I started actually, like, you know, caring about...
Right.
I was able to choose the things that I watched then.
Previous to that, your parents chose what you watched?
I mean, I was only allowed to watch, like, a half hour a night, I think, until that point.
Oh, my God. That's... You just described the worst thing I can think of.
So, I don't really remember before... the earliest TV that I remember choosing to watch was, like, Fresh Prince and Roseanne.
Right, right.
And, like, maybe maybe the Muppet Show. No, yeah, some fine choices.
If my parents told me you can only watch a half hour television a night, I would have heard, we're only going to allow you to breathe for a half hour an evening. And I would have been like, that sounds severe.
I understand. Sometimes I would, you know, get home from school before my parents and I would sneak some TV viewing. Or like when I remember I had a babysitter once and I was, you know, they probably were told, you're supposed to go to bed at this time. But I was like, oh no, sometimes I'm
They're
also...
wrong.
Yeah.
Sometimes they get confused.
I believe my parents are mistaken about the rules for my childhood.
I used to babysit for one of my mother's friend's kids and they went to bed at, I think, 7. And and she'd give me like money for pizza and the kids didn't like the pizza. So I'd just get whatever I wanted. And I used to, and she'd leave it around 4 o'clock. And around 5, I moved all the clocks to say 7 o'clock. And then I was like, it's 7 o'clock. And they were like, because they knew what 7 o'clock looked like on the clock. So they were like, oh, you're right. Okay. And they went to bed at 5. And then I put them back to 7.
That is insane. I babysat for some kids. And I remember this one kid, I was probably like 13.
Yeah.
And this kid was like 5.
Kid was like 15.
Yeah. 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 And well, I mean, I think his older sister was like 1 year younger than me.
Okay.
So she could have been babysitting. But I got my $4, I don't know.
Right.
Whatever it was. But I remember, I feel like I loved Inspector Gadget, and it was like...
Who didn't?
It came on after Looney Tunes. It was like Looney Tunes, then Inspector Gadget. But at a certain point, the kid stopped enjoying Inspector Gadget, so he'd be like, Looney Tunes is over, now we're gonna, like, interact. And I was like, no. Let's keep... And so I was... Inspector Gadget would come on, and I'd be like, let's watch. And he's like, I don't want to watch Inspector Gadget. I'm like, oh, no, that's just a commercial.
Right.
It's still Looney Tunes.
It's
Looney
a 30-hour, it's a 30-minute commercial.
Yeah, it's pretty great.
Here's a saw. Go outside and play for half an hour.
It has its own commercials.
My mother used to do daycare for various kids when I was growing up, and she was home to earn extra money when we were on government assistance and would get tubs of peanut butter and free government cheese. But there was this one kid who his parents were like, the only rule is he absolutely... will not watch The Electric Company. And so, which I loved The Electric Company because like, Spider-Man was on it.
Challenge accepted.
Yeah, so I would always put it on. I must have been 3 or 4, and this kid would freak. Like, he'd start screaming. It was horrific.
Was it the electricity or the company that he...
I don't know. I think he just hated Morgan Freeman.
Fair enough.
I think that might have been it. All right, so we get May 30th. You picked it because it was in the era that you most remember television.
And the first one that I looked at had, like, Arsenio on the cover, and I never watched Arsenio, so I found one.
Lucky you.
This one has... The Wonder Years on the cover, which is...
Right, which is a great show.
Absolutely.
So, yep, it's The Wonder Years on the cover. It's the special family vacation issue of TV Guide, and The Wonder Years are on the cover, including Jason Hervey, my nemesis. So, Saturday night, we start the week, as TV Guide weeks all start on a Saturday night. What do you got at 8 o'clock?
The Golden Girls.
Classic Saturday night show.
It was between that and Who's the Boss.
Right.
There was a time when, in high school, after my parents got divorced, and I was now on my own a lot more.
Right.
To, you know, eat whatever. I was like, now all of a sudden, like, I wasn't allowed to have, like, sugary cereals originally.
All bets are off.
The TV, yes. Like, I did my own shopping, and, like, I got Doritos.
So it was like Home Alone all the time.
Kind of. Yeah, home with my mom sometimes there.
Okay.
Alone. Mostly. I mean, my mom, she was a good mom.
Yeah, up until that time.
You know, and then even better after that.
Right.
But I remember then I would just, we had just moved, and so I didn't have, like, tons of friends or anything, so after school I would do my homework, and then from, like, 6 p.m. till midnight, I would just be in front of the TV.
Yes.
And so, you know, watching, like, reruns of things. Sometimes
now we're talking.
I watched a good 40 hours a week of TV in high school. And
it's a full-time job.
And then I remember even in college, like, when I would come home, I would go out with friends sometimes then, because I now then did have friends.
Right.
But I would still, like, set the various VCRs so that I could watch TV all day of what was on the night before.
I knew there was a reason we've been friends.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So I definitely, in this situation, I would have certainly taped one of Who's the Boss and then watch, or Golden Girls, and then watch the other one.
Right.
Because I remember I watched both of those shows.
Yeah, this was when, in 92 was sort of the last year of Who's the Boss and the last year of Growing Pains, and TGIF was very popular. So ABC tried to make Saturday night also a TGIF, and they moved Growing Pains and Who's the Boss to 8 o'clock on Saturdays from Wednesdays.
TGIS, which on the telephone would sound exactly, it's very difficult
to tell
SNF apart.
But that could be, thank God it's Satan.
Mm-hmm.
Which would be fun. But they didn't call it TGIS. They called it Saturday Night is Funny. which was really weak.
That is not as catchy.
Yeah. So this was the last season of both shows. Who's the Boss? I always watched it because, although I hated Tony Danza, I really, really loved Alyssa Milano.
Sure.
I watched it even though I didn't enjoy it. This episode's not great. Tony strikes out with Samantha when he refuses to get her a job, recalling the error he made helping Jonathan become ball boy for the Mets.
Oh.
I think that you'd never get over that if you helped someone become ball boy for the Mets.
I don't think so.
So, Golden Girls was clearly the move here. Much better episode. Glance, the reigning bell of the Rusty Anchor Bar, already great. Already great. Gets gonged when Dorothy starts to sing. Meanwhile, Sophia throws a wake for herself, but unfortunately lets Rose make the arrangements. I mean, the A story and B story here, fantastic.
I mean, you can't go wrong with any of those ladies.
Not at all.
She was throwing her own wake.
Yes.
I don't know why is she doing that.
I think she was trying to guilt trip B. Arthur.
Okay.
It's a good episode. Sure. Worth checking out again. The other things you passed up now, I was a big fan of Cops. Most Saturday nights I watch Cops, but I think Golden Girls was the move here. And Baywatch had just started. This is when it was on NBC.
I never watched Baywatch. I did have a free shirt that I got, which said on the back of it, in like however many countries and however many languages, it had the numbers. Like right. 37 countries.
Huge
maybe,
show.
Maybe 100 countries and like 37 languages.
Right.
And like more people are watching Baywatch than anything else.
Than reading the Bible.
In the world. Yeah.
Yes.
And I got that shirt for free at College Fest.
I got a bunch of free shirts when I worked at a local TV station, and one was from the show Felicity, which I never watched, but apparently she had to choose between a guy named Ben and a guy named Noel.
Yeah.
So this shirt just...
Noel, now on Scandal.
Oh, nice. This shirt just said Ben or Noel, and it didn't say what it was from, and my dad was always on me to get him promotional stuff, so I gave him this Ben or Noel shirt, and he wore it every day. Like, anytime I saw him, he had this Ben or Noel shirt on, and he never asked what it was for.
Oh, wow.
Or why?
You should talk about that on stage. That's
funny. I probably should.
That's, I like that guy who played Noel. I'm all Noel all the
you
way.
You're Noel. You're not a Ben in the Ben camp.
And I actually also did, I watched the first episode of Felicity, and I got mad because she went across the country to follow a guy instead of going to pre-med at Stanford, like was her plan for her future. It was very anti-feminist.
You would get mad at that.
I heard that it was good over the next 4 years.
Once she cut her hair, it got a lot better.
That's what they say. Yeah. And then I did watch the end of the show, which they did two different endings. They did like four episodes.
One Ben, one Noel.
They really did. And there was some like mystical like witchcraft explanation for how they could have both of those things happen.
They were dead the whole time and she was autistic.
Yep.
Yep. Just like on Saint Elsewhere. Okay. Just for completion's sake, I feel the need to read you the plot of Baywatch that night.
Fair enough.
Reports of a coming storm bring back painful memories for Mitch, and even better, Kay attempts to persuade the parents of a young deaf girl to send her daughter to sign language school, which is exactly what lifeguards should do. They're
really, like, a lot of people think that lifeguards are just about, you know, saving you from drowning, but they're really guarding your whole life.
You're living even when you're not swimming, and that's what they say.
Most of the time, you're not swimming.
Yeah, I would say the majority of your life is spent not swimming.
In this day and age, like, back before we evolved, you know, and came out of the oceans.
Right. So, and they didn't even have lifeguards then, which was a shame.
Everybody knew how to swim.
Exactly. So at 7:30, what do you go with?
I believe I stayed on the same channel for the Torkelsons.
I never liked the Torkelsons.
I don't think I liked it, but I mean, I liked that lady. There's like, you know, that lady with the Southern accent.
Yep.
I forget.
I think it was Amy Hathaway.
It's definitely, she was like a really familiar looking lady.
Right.
And I was like, I liked her. And I don't remember the show at all, but I'm sure that I watched it.
I watched it as well, and I don't remember a lot of the show, although I always remember it made me sad. It was a comedy, but it felt really sad. Like, when I think of the Torkelsons, I feel like every episode was a sad Southern girl sitting on a porch swing and being sad for
a
half hour.
Like, Southern sad Punky Brewster.
Exactly, exactly.
I like the name Torkelsons, though.
Torkelsons is a good name.
Real fun to say.
Yeah.
That's probably how it became a show.
Yeah.
We've got it. The Torkelsons. What's that? Doesn't matter.
We'll figure it out.
Yeah.
Just give us an air date and you'll have something.
Put Torkelsons in the TV guide.
I think my move here, now normally probably would have been Cops, but MTV was airing a 120 minutes concert tour, which was a look at alternative rock music, which this would have been absolutely what I would have watched.
Would have been clicking back and forth between, like, MTV is a thing that I never, like, watched for more than 3 minutes at a time.
Okay. Just a video at once.
Yes. Usually. I mean, I would check and see what videos were on and hopefully, you know, I hated when it was like, I didn't, in this day, I would probably be okay with a Mariah Carey video.
Right.
Like, it would, nostalgic-wise. But I didn't care for Mariah Carey as a teenager.
Because you hated women and black people.
Exactly. I didn't even know she was a black person, but I, you know, it got to me.
I believe I asked you this before, but Brenda Kaplan, who recorded under the name Brenda K. Starr, who did the song I Still Believe, which Mariah Carey covered later.
Brenda Starr, isn't that like one of those Mary Worth-like comic strips?
It was a comic strip. Yep. She got it from a comic strip. She's from New York. Her name is Brenda Kaplan. Mariah Carey started as her backup singer, and I think I asked you if you were related to Brenda Kaplan.
And I probably told you that I don't think I am.
You don't think you were.
In fact, I got an email just the other day from a guy named Quinn Kaplan, who was like super excited. He'd seen my comedy.
Is he a doctor?
I don't know who this person... No. A medicine Kaplan. This kid said, I assume it's a kid, but he was so excited. He's like, my grandfather was a Jew, and my dad's name is Mike, and my last name is Kaplan. What's going, do you know about how many Kaplans are there? Are there just a lot of Kaplans?
That's better than him going, stop ripping me off.
Oh, no, he was really excited, and I was like, I don't know about it. I'm not your dad, if that's what you're saying.
No one ever purports to be related to me. The only time anyone ever mentioned my last name Reed, which is spelled R-E-I-D, was a black dude told me, man, you spell it the black way. Which apparently I do. It's R-E-E-D is the normal non-black way.
Sticking it to the white man.
It's true.
What were we saying? Oh, yeah. I would have definitely... Oh, the point was that Mariah Carey one time, I think the song Hero...
Yep. When a hero comes along.
That's probably all you have the rights to.
Yep.
It was on MTV and VH1, just like 3 seconds apart. Like, they were playing the same... And I was like,
it transcended all demographics.
I can't... And I was like, I didn't... So I watched a commercial, probably.
I think someone should mash up I Need a Hero and Hero by Mariah Carey.
Oh, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Work on it.
So, yeah, 120 minutes was my thing, man. I recorded... That was on midnight to 2 a.m. normally, so this was a rare primetime 120 minute special. Mm-hmm. But I recorded it every Sunday night, and then every Monday after school, I watched that and made it with a notebook and wrote down albums that I wanted to buy. Because that's what people used to do then.
This is actually even... 1992 was probably the year that I first started purchasing music. Because I, up until that point, like, just my family listened to... My mom listened to Billy Joel and John Denver.
Okay.
So that was the only music I really knew as a child.
I'm so sorry.
And then when I was 13, which is what I turned in 1992.
When you became a man.
I wouldn't have yet... At this point, I didn't have a Walkman. I didn't have anything. But I got a Walkman for my birthday that year.
Right.
And started purchasing cassettes, the first of which were Cypress Hill Black Sunday.
Okay, you jumped right in.
Aerosmith, Get a Grip.
Okay.
Counting Crows, August and Everything After.
Very sorry.
Soundgarden, Super Unknown.
What a collection.
And Dennis Leary, No Cure for Cancer.
The collection you've described leads me to believe that you purchased these from Columbia House. I feel like that was the Columbia House starting package.
It might have been, but I honestly might have gone to a store and picked them out.
Wow. Wow, because you could have, like most 13-year-olds at that time, just committed mail fraud and got them off for a penny.
I think I definitely did that once. But here's the thing: is I think I got one of the legal letters that they send people,
right,
and I got scared by it.
You got freaked out.
I got scared by authority, and I think I sent them the money.
For BMG, which I can talk about now because it no longer exists, I used to get Reed, Kenneth, Kyle Reed. I had all kinds of aliases that were getting various CDs.
But also at this time, I did not yet. I don't think we had cable. I didn't have cable until I moved, which was when I was 13. Also,
okay, so that's when your parents were like, "You've had your bar mitzvah. Yeah. You're a man. Here's the cable."
Exactly.
It'd be funny if they had a room you weren't allowed in that had cable the whole time, and they just gave you a key to that room. Now
it would have been. That is not what happened. You've got a great imagination.
Well, thank you. 9 p.m. What do you go with?
And just to, I think you're going back and forth between the Central and Eastern time, but...
Yeah, so this, the particular TV guide that Mike picked is Central, so normally we go from 8 to 10, but this one we have to go to 7 to 9, because that would be the prime time.
So this one is, in this guide, listed as 8 p.m.,
but it's actually 9 p.m. 9
p.m., where we grew up.
The real America.
Yeah. Empty Nest.
Empty Nest. Now, normally I would back that.
Mm-hmm.
I liked Empty Nest. I was a Richard Mulligan fan. However... Billy was on at this time on ABC.
I don't know that I know what Billy is.
Billy was Billy Connolly's sitcom. It was a spin-off of Head of the Class. He replaced Howard Hessman in the last year of Head of the Class as their teacher. And he played the same character, Billy. Once Head of the Class got canceled, he moved on to Billy, which lasted one season.
Was he still teaching?
He was still a teacher. He was renting a room in a single mother's house. I will say this, it wasn't a great show.
But I don't remember that at all, but today I probably would watch that instead.
Because I find Billy Connell, I'll watch him in anything.
He's a pleasure to watch.
He's great. So Empty Nest, you would have gone with a decent episode that night. Billy, not that great, but a better move, I think. Let's move on to 9:30 rather.
8:30 Central. I would, as a child, 100% Perfect Strangers.
Yeah, I agree.
I also watched Nurses.
Nurses was good.
Yeah.
Nurses was a rare...
Paul Provenza in that?
Paul Provenza was briefly on Nurses.
Yeah.
He showed up in a lot of sitcoms. Paul Provenza was in a sitcom called The Pursuit of Happiness. That was the first sitcom he was on NBC. He was one of those guys that someone at NBC just loved and tried to stick in absolutely everything and constantly give him a sitcom. So he was in The Pursuit of Happiness, which did only last about 8 episodes. When that was canceled, he was added to the cast of The Facts of Life as Blair's love interest.
Wow.
He was on the last season of that. Then, this was also while he was doing Kids Court. I mean, he was doing a lot of stuff at this time and doing Comics Only on Comedy Central.
They should have had a show about, like, today, the right. Paul Provenza, like, experience starring Fred Stoller.
Yes.
Like, all,
yes.
Any of those guys.
Right. And then he replaced Rob Morrow on Northern Exposure.
Okay.
He was just, they'd
which
plug him in anywhere.
You've watched and I did not watch as regularly.
Love Northern Exposure despite really hating Rob Morrow.
Understood.
Yeah.
Which we won't get to because it is not a primetime.
It's not a primetime show, but it was a great show.
Perfect Strangers was, like, when Perfect Strangers went off the air, I remember being so sad.
Oh, yeah.
And it went off, and then I think there was always, like, a rumor that, oh, it could come back as a mid-season replacement, and I was just waiting and waiting.
What
and
a cruel rumor.
Years had passed, and finally, I think, you know, when I was more grown, like, in college, I watched a rerun, and I was like, this is awful.
It's awful. It'd be funny if people were like, it could come back as a series of films, like Star Trek. Who's playing Balky now?
Yeah.
Perfect Strangers, this was also the final season of Perfect Strangers. So again, ABC really dumped their long-standing 80s shows on this Saturday night lineup. This was when Balky and Larry became married, not to each other.
Okay.
They lived in a Victorian house. To each other, it'd still be on today. this particular episode, Balky lands an assignment to draw a Chronicle comic strip of Dimitri, the cuddly sheep, but it gets Larry's goat when Wainwright assigns him to, quote, fill in the bubbles.
Oh, man.
Yeah. Little puns in there by the person from TV Guide.
Good work, guys.
Nurses is a rare show in that it's a spinoff of a spinoff.
How's that?
Empty Nest, spinoff of Growing Pains.
Okay.
I mean, not Growing Pains, Golden Girls.
Right.
Nurses, spinoff of Empty Nest.
How has that ever happened since?
Let me think. I feel like it has. Nothing comes to mind,
okay,
however,
we'll
but I'm pretty certain that it is. I'm sure people can write in and tell me if I'm missing anything. All right, so that is Saturday night. I think that either Nurses or Perfect Strangers was the move. Your other chance was Vinny and Bobby on Fox, which was an awful Matt LeBlanc show.
Oh, now I remember that, and I today actually might watch that out of curiosity.
Yeah, really, really terrible.
Matt LeBlanc doing great on episodes.
He is, that's great.
It's funny.
I love Tamsin Grieg, who's on episodes. I'm a big fan of hers. Matt LeBlanc, I believe, from Newton, Mass.
Oh, that could be.
And Matt, the other Matt from Friends, is also from Massachusetts.
Oh, Matthew Perry?
Matthew Perry, also from Massachusetts.
Good work. Good work, this part of the...
For some reason on this podcast, I always feel the need to mention who's from Massachusetts or things that are set in Massachusetts, even though that's probably not interesting to anybody.
You're allowed to do that.
Thank you.
It's your podcast.
Monday night... did we do Sunday?
Nope.
I skipped Sunday.
Yep.
Yeah, let's go to Sunday night. What do you got? 8:00.
We've got, I would probably have told my friends that I watched In Living Color, but in actuality, Murder, She Wrote.
Wow, I thought you were going actuality Funniest Home Videos.
Ha! I did watch Funniest Home Videos as well, but, like, I spent a lot of my childhood, like, I'd spend nights with my grandmother, and so there was a lot of, that's why Golden
Murder,
Girls and Murder, She Wrote.
His grandmother goes, I'm only watching people on TV that are my age or older.
I like to look like it's a mirror.
Right, exactly. Did she do her makeup in front of the TV? I look good tonight.
I'm like, Angela Lansbury, I really enjoy, I mean, I haven't watched Murder, She Wrote as an adult, but I'm pretty sure it holds up as, like, the Law and Order of its time.
Yeah, it's very similar to Law and Order. This particular episode, in her new role as a teacher, Jessica is challenged to find a campus killer by the ex-cop turned professor who used to teach her class. And it stars Wings Hauser, who was a real creep in a lot of movies in the 80s. This was also, I believe, the last or the second to last season of Murder, She Wrote, where they kind of changed the format a little bit and she was a teacher. I definitely would have gone with Funniest Home Videos at this time. And
sure.
My school, you you were either a Funniest Home Videos or a Living Color person. And Living Color I liked kind of for the first season, and then it just sort of got lazy, catchphrasy, and I found it to be sort of hateful.
Okay.
But and also, by the time school rolled around on Monday, I would get the whole show acted back to me by everyone I went to school with. Funniest Home Videos, I just should mention, I always like that they bother to put what's on that episode of Funniest Home Videos.
What do they put?
This one says, a hedge-trimming nun doesn't get her feet planted. A young girl realizes something's fishy after tasting squid, and an optical illusion has a toddler, quote, making water.
Now, does somebody, who comes up with that? Does somebody watch everything that's on and then comes up with
these? I think so.
Or somebody from the show is like, here's what happened.
They never tell us in TV Guide. If I could ever meet someone who worked for TV Guide or work, because I think it probably works differently now, I would love to hear, did you get preview tapes to write this? Did they give you a synopsis? Because there's definitely a flavor, a consistency to the writing where I feel like someone on staff wrote this. I don't think this is a press release.
But it would be impossible for them to watch everything that's on
right. So
in
not,
their life.
Not everything has a synopsis.
Okay.
So this one's great. Like, I feel like someone's like, I might watch Funniest Home Videos with a hedge trimming nun.
No, not into that.
Oh, tasting squid. I'll watch that. So also Super Bloopers and Practical Jokes was on, which I was a big fan of. This episode doesn't really have any names aside from Sherman Helmsley, who's the victim of a practical joke.
Fair enough.
Involving the master tapes for an album he recorded. That just sounds just mean.
Well, yep.
We lost him. Ha ha.
Oh, I'm not a fan of most pranks at all.
No, they're pretty mean-spirited.
Unless you, yeah, if you say immediately, like, here's the closest I came was with a waitress. You know, I enjoy, like, making wait people laugh. I like doing, and I'm sure they hear tons of jokes, so I'm always willing to be like, oh, have you heard? I try to do original jokes to, like, not on waiter.
You would write the joke for them.
Oh, yeah.
Is that how you get away with not tipping?
Exactly.
Yeah. You Picasso tip. It. And yeah. Here is my tip.
Full disclosure of truth, I actually tip waitstaff generally 20%.
Excellent.
And if they're the worst, you're getting 15%, still an acceptable tip.
Yeah, that's still an acceptable tip.
But yeah, it was between 4 and 5, they were switching over from brunch to dinner. So
right.
The waitstaff, and we were there through brunch, but people were gathering. It was an Aaron Judge birthday party.
Okay.
And so people were coming and going throughout the afternoon. So
right.
Some people got there before, had brunch. Some people were coming later.
So drop it.
Yeah, exactly. And but between 4 and 5, the waitress was very careful to come around and be like, "We're, you know, the kitchen's
changing
closing.
Shifts.
Yeah, so there's not going to be.
Give me my tip.
Oh no, she was still right. There being the waitress, but she was just saying like, if you want any food, make sure to order it before 4.
Right.
Otherwise, you'll have to wait till 5. It was she made it clear to everybody many times, and so I then picked up the menu at a certain point that I always thought it would be very clear to be like, okay, I've finally decided. You know, it's now 4:15.
Yeah, you're making a joke.
Finally decided. I'll have. And then her face starts to drop, and I'm like, I am joking. You are clearly a good waitress.
Well, I mean, how far would you go with that? Would you do the whole order and then 10 minutes later be like, where's my goddamn food? And then be like, I'm kidding.
No. I mean,
yeah, because, that was when you had to bail
right,
out.
Right. Oh, that was my intention the whole time. I didn't think I was going to make up, like, because that's what a prank is. Making
right.
somebody feel bad. It's like a roller coaster. You're like, I think I'm going to die. Oh, I'm not dead.
Right.
Like, it has to be very quick.
Yeah. My dad's a big pranker. And so I inherited a bit of that. But like what we would do, one of my favorite ones was if a friend was sleeping over, I had a tape of truck noises, and what I would do is while they were asleep, I'd play the truck noises, shine 2 flashlights in their eyes, and yell truck. And one kid actually peed himself. And then I was like, maybe I'll stop doing
but
this.
I mean, it's like that's an impossible. There's no way that there's a truck where they
no,
are.
No, but they're, you yeah. know, they don't have their cognitive ability.
You're right, they're asleep.
They're asleep, you know, it's not.
Here's,
it's a cruel trick.
On the flip side, here's, you know, Henry Phillips.
Yes.
Hilarious comedian. Watch the movie Punching the Clown. He, so many wonderful stories. See him do comedy. Like, you should try to get him on when next time he comes to Massachusetts.
I'm sure he would come
to this house. But so here's one of his stories that it's not even a story, but just he said he was working at a club. He got in on Thursday to, you know, do radio. He's like, so the guy calls him up who runs the club and is like,
right.
Thursday night, he calls him and says, we got to do radio. We got to leave at like 5 in the morning. And Henry's like, oh, man. And then the guy's like, gotcha. No, we don't.
It's 5:30.
Yeah. I mean, and maybe there wasn't like whatever. Either there wasn't
yeah.
radio or it was much later at a more reasonable time.
Right.
But the guy for the rest of the weekend was like, oh, I got him real good. And Henry's
yeah.
like, but you're the guy that tells me when radio is.
That
was a thing. And he's like, he was a pretty good sport about it, though.
Right. And that was also, although sucky, a reasonable hour for radio to start. If he was like, it's going to start at 2 a.m., more clearly a joke.
Yeah, Henry was not gotten in this story. He believed the man who was telling him a thing that could be reasonable.
Yeah, that's a poor joke. I try to avoid joking with waitstaff, but I remember I was very embarrassed. I was eating at, it was like a TGI Fridays type restaurant where they made all the waitstaff wear silly hats.
Oh, sure.
And this girl had a big cowboy hat on, and my friend that I was eating with goes, ordered his soda, and he goes, oh yes, waitress, called her back and went, can I also get 10 gallons of that soda, and can you put it in that hat? And she was angry and embarrassed. I don't think she found it funny.
That is a funny thing to say.
It was funny. It wasn't funny, but just it didn't go over well.
My normal thing that I'll do that has gotten over well with waitstaff. In fact, one time, if I have a completely empty plate, yeah. As they're taking it away, I'll say, please get that wrapped up. Especially if there's garbage on the plate. Like my napkins. Yeah, food. Clearly, could we get that wrapped up? And she looked down and then laughed and then turned and handed it to another waitress who hadn't heard and said, can you wrap this up? Can you put this in a box?
And you're like, I have a goat at home.
Paid it forward. Yeah.
Nice. So at 8:30, you didn't have to pick because you picked an hour long show.
Still watching.
Your options were America's Funniest People, which was terrible, and Rock, which was a good show.
Did watch it sometimes. Yes.
Live show. So move on to 9 o'clock. I think I probably know what you picked, but what do you got?
Of course, Married with Children.
Married with Children.
Which I have a long, complicated relationship with because I wasn't allowed to watch it.
Right. You had to sneak?
Probably at this time I was not allowed to watch it. So yeah, if I got to see it, it was like a very exciting, risque, edgy thing.
Oh yeah.
And then eventually I was allowed to watch it, and then I got like too cool for it.
Right.
And I was like, this is stupid.
I mean, it was on for 11 seasons.
And then later I started watching it sort of as an adult, probably.
Right.
Like when I was, at least in college, I was like, oh, or beyond that, I'd watch reruns, and I purchased it when it was on DVD, and I was like, this is really quality. It's a funny show, at least for a good portion of it.
Yeah, I mean, I liked it at the time, and then I realized, and I've said this before to people, that it sort of annoyed me in that I have a chip on my shoulder about blue-collar sitcoms, and I found this to be very offensive to blue-collar people. It was like I've called it this before, and if people have heard me say this, I apologize, but I like to call it, it's like a poverty minstrel show, in that we're sort of laughing at these cartoonish poor people.
Which we're doing now in real life, or like with reality shows, with actual people.
Right, without the writing there. So, there were definitely episodes I enjoyed, but my tolerance for Married with Children is very limited.
I understand that.
In small bits.
I like that that the wife was constantly trying to have sex with the husband, but he was the one who didn't want
it. And she's very attractive.
Oh, yeah.
And
way more attractive than him.
I said that to my dad once. I said, I don't understand what his problem is because she's very attractive. And my dad said, it's different when it's your wife.
Ha, ha, ha. What? Just what you want to hear from your dad.
Exactly. Good advice.
Eventually, I now have, I think fondly of that show, and there's some really funny
there's
moments.
Some nostalgia factor there. It was up against Seinfeld, which was in its first season.
Which at the time I wouldn't have known about.
Very few people watched it at this time.
But in this day and age, I would choose to watch Seinfeld over Married with Children.
I would have watched Seinfeld then, I will admit. But let me read you the Married with Children synopsis for that night, because I feel like the TV Guide writer really structurally nailed this one.
Okay.
The good. Bud wins a house party with a thrash metal band, Anthrax.
Ha.
The bad. Alan Pegg. The ugly. Getting them out of the house with the help of Ed Cookie Burns.
Oh, wow.
So you got a lot of guest stars in that episode.
Absolutely.
8:30, what do you got?
Herman's Head.
Herman's Head.
I loved at the time. And
I'm sorry, 9:30.
Yep, haven't seen since.
Herman's Head, good show. I thought it was a clever show, had a really good cast.
Hank Azaria,
Yardley Smith. Also you had the main guy whose name
William
is
Ragsdale.
William Ragsdale.
Of
that's
Mannequin
right.
fame.
Of, Mannequin 2 on the right. move. He's not in the original Mannequin. However, he is in Fright Night and Fright Night Part 2. Which is why I started watching Herman's Head, actually, because I recognized him from Fright Night.
Herman's Head, even now thinking about, there's... no shows specifically do... it was an original idea for a show.
Yeah, it was a good show. And I think that it would work now. If you did that show.
Bring it back, guys.
Although now they'd probably make it a dark, hour-long drama about a man with multiple personality disorder.
Yeah.
I probably
would... They bring it back and call it The United States of Tara.
Yes, exactly. That is a remake of Herman Said. Mm-hmm. I think I would have watched Night Court. So this was also the last season of Night Court. I've been watching Night Court since it was on. It was on now on Sunday nights. And although I liked Herman's Head for this year, I definitely would have watched Night Court.
I later would have. I'd never watched Night Court while it was on. I only found it and loved it in reruns. In that chunk of time in high school when it was probably on every night at 11 or 11:30.
Right, back to back.
Yeah, on like the WB or UPN or the thing was at the time.
Great show.
Yes.
Also, I assume at 10 o'clock you would have watched Quantum Leap that night.
Oh, absolutely.
Sort of outside of our scope here, but
loved
I
loved it.
Just wanted to mention that. So on to Monday, the saddest night of the week, in my opinion. You've gone back to school, you've gone back to work.
Oh, yeah.
You generally need a really solid night of TV to make you forget about the troubles of the day. What do you go with at 8 p.m.?
I went with Fresh Prince at the time.
Not surprised. Not surprised. This episode had a guest appearance by Queen Latifah.
Great.
So even better. Mm-hmm. Really, the only other option you had at this time was Evening Shade.
Oh, yeah. Didn't watch that.
It's not a bad show. Burt Reynolds is always entertaining. I like Mary Lou Henner, but definitely an old person show. Yeah. It was definitely a CBS show.
They were really finding their voice, their
exactly,
brand.
Exactly. Exactly. So there we go. Fresh Prince, 8 o'clock. 8:30. I'm assuming you probably stayed on
sticking
NBC.
Sticking with Blossom.
Stuck with Blossom. I really like Jenna Von Oy.
Doesn't
get enough credit.
Real cute.
She was cute. She was also doing double duty at this time because she was starring in the Lenny Clark sitcom Lenny.
Oh, didn't know that.
Where she played his daughter. This episode of Blossom learns why Six is spending so much time at the Russos. Meanwhile, the waitress Joey likes at his new part-time job doesn't speak English.
Which is... I guess uncommon at the time.
Apparently it is. Also, I just want to mention that opposite Blossom, there was a show called Focus on Britain.
Okay.
And the episode description is as follows: a Scottish bakery is visited.
All right.
So you didn't watch that.
You probably would already have to be planning to watch.
That sounds like if a kid had to come up with a hypothetical boring show, it would be a show called Focus on Britain, a Scottish bakery is visited.
Yeah, maybe a scarf store after.
Right. It's like that in National Lampoon's European Vacation when they're in the hotel and Rusty, all the things on TV are just documentaries about cheese.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, very similar. So 9 o'clock, what do you got?
I would have done the hour-long Murphy Brown.
Yes, hour-long Murphy Brown. It's a very special Murphy Brown. It's the first episode where she reveals she thinks she's pregnant, which was a huge cultural phenomenon at the time. This was a big deal. This was appointment television.
And that show, that was one that it was like a more grown-up show than I was necessarily.
Right.
But I would watch it, like, you know, with my mom or something. And like then as I got older, I would appreciate, like, there's one episode that I really remember that still to this day, I think it was about when she had the child, spoiler.
Right.
The kid was like 2 years old and she was doing like an expose on modern art.
Was the kid's name Avery?
Yeah, that's right. Yep. So Avery did some finger paintings.
Right.
And she was like, this looks like modern art.
Right.
So I'm going to trick people. She put the name on it, A. Veret.
Okay.
And they're like...
Sounds a little French.
Yeah, an artist from, you know, from Europe. Like, right. New, up and coming in the art. Like, maybe you haven't seen all of his work yet, but... And she presented that alongside with an established modern art piece.
Right.
That, you know... And she said she presented it... To, I forget exactly how she did it. She said, one of these is real, one of these is fake.
Right.
But she presented them both to a panel of art experts. And she was hoping to be like, gotcha!
Right.
You know, and the first guy who looks at her child's piece is like, this actually looks like garbage. He's like, this looks like a child could have done this.
Right.
Like, what is going on?
He was correct.
I don't like it at all. And she was like, oh, maybe there is something to this. He's an expert. He knows what he's talking about. And then the next expert was like, I could not disagree more.
Right.
This is fantastic. You've always been quick to, like, dismiss the newest, the people from...
Got the personal in there.
It was great. It was, like, one of those episodes where, like, there's a Christmas miracle. Like, oh, maybe there is a God.
Right.
But then you find out, oh, it was actually human intervention. Something happened.
It was a homeless person.
But then another sort of potentially real-life miraculous thing happened.
So you got a real philosophical education from this episode of Murphy Brown.
It really stuck with me.
I think what you've described could easily be a reality show. Now, where it's a child does art, an artist does art.
Oh,
try to fool experts.
Great,
huge show.
I like it.
We could pitch that as well. So we move on to Tuesday, 7 p.m. What do you got?
Would have definitely, at the time, been Full House.
Yeah, I think Full House was the move here. I was a big fan of this one. This has a very special guest star, now forgotten, singer Tommy Page.
Oh, didn't know.
He was sort of a teen heartthrob for about 20 minutes. He's Stephanie's monumental crush, but her feelings are squashed when Tommy pays more attention to DJ.
Well, why would he do that? She's older, more mature, better looking.
Not a child. Yeah, there was a weird subgenre of episodes where children in sitcoms met their rock star hero. In this case, it's a real guy. My favorite episode was of Growing Pains, where Brad Pitt actually played a rock star. Ben meets him backstage and then forgets his autograph book. So when he comes back in, Brad Pitt's making out with some girl that's not his wife. And Ben goes, "Hey, that's not your wife." And he goes, "Will you get out of here, you little snot?" And then Ben goes home and tears down his posters. And the lesson there is that your heroes are jerks.
Yeah, that makes sense. And then Kirk Cameron, like, true to form.
Awful. Makes out with people that aren't his wife.
I mean, you know, makes out with the idea of creationism.
Exactly, exactly.
Here's a thing that I've almost certainly told you before, but will tell your listeners. My cousin, do you know the thing?
He co-wrote Stephanie's book.
He was the ghostwriter. His name is on the cover, so it's like,
yeah,
Jody Sweetin with Jonathan Warwick.
Right.
And the book title that he came up with, Unsweetened.
Nice. About her. Is that what got him the gig?
Might have been.
Yeah.
It was like the Torkelsons.
Artificial sweetener. Absolutely. How about that? No.
We've got it.
Yeah, we got it. Unsweetened. I believe I own that book.
Fair enough.
In my collection of celebrity biographies.
Everyone should. My cousin probably gets a few cents.
Yeah, buy it from Mike's cousin.
Yeah.
Jody Sweetin doesn't get any money, but she just spent it on drugs.
She's got a ton. Yeah.
Yeah. So at 8:30, what do you got?
I did watch Home Improvement.
I'm so sorry, Mike. Yeah. What a terrible, terrible show. This was everything I hated about family sitcoms in the 90s.
I liked Wilson.
A lot of people use that justification. It's kind of like if there's a racist band and people go, "The music's pretty good, just don't listen to the lyrics."
You're right. Wilson is the music.
Wilson is the screwdriver of...
Will we see his face? Will we ever?
Never. So you just like the mystery. Did they ever show his face?
I don't believe they ever fully did.
What a tease.
And then every once in a while, you'd see him, like, his back was, like, he wasn't behind the fence.
Right.
And you're like, is it now? And then he was, like, you know, holding a book or
right.
something.
Whenever I think of Home Improvement, I get a visual sort of physical sensation of being inside a mobile Quickie Mart. Like just like a Hess station. That's what I think of Home Improvement. Just like standing in the middle of a Hess station at like 2 o'clock on a Sunday. And that's how I think of Home Improvement. I don't know if that makes any sense, but that's
fair enough.
That's how
I absolutely wouldn't watch it. For any, like, at the time, I didn't know better.
Yeah, fair enough. This episode was in June 2nd. However, it was the rerun of the Christmas episode, which they really should do in July for the Christmas in July.
That makes sense.
Tim's efforts to wrest a Christmas decoration prize from a neighbor win him a visit from the fire department. And is this Mark's last season with Santa?
Ooh.
It's a good one. I have watched that one because I do watch the Christmas specials every year. But
Of everything,
but still don't like the show. 9 p.m.
Absolutely, Roseanne.
No question about it, Roseanne. Even if there wasn't really anything else on at that time worth watching, which was true. You had like Law and Order and Frontline and that kind of stuff. And Roseanne was really the only sitcom on. But what a great show. Never got bad. Even though people don't like the last season, I still enjoy it.
In retrospect, like, I like what they did.
Oh, the twist at the end is so sad and brilliant and great and makes even the low points of the last season just worth it.
Absolutely.
Great show. This is the episode where after Roseanne throws her back out, Bev arrives to help out and to help spoil the grandkids by offering to buy Becky a car and DJ a video game. Anytime Bev showed up, it was always great. They just played her so well.
Yeah. Roseanne was a show that sometimes this might have been like just past my bedtime. My bedtime might have been 9 o'clock.
You had a bedtime.
Oh, at some points in
I never had a bedtime in my childhood.
But yeah, I remember Roseanne. Sometimes like Roseanne night, I was like, "Can I stay up to watch Roseanne?" And I could.
You had to do the negotiation. Did your parents watch it with you?
Yeah. Like they would be watching it, and so I would watch it with them.
That's good then. So that's definitely the move. Although on USA Network, they were showing the movie The Fury, which I do like, which features the wonderful Amy Irving exploding people's heads with telekinesis, which is one of my favorite things.
I might check that out, but I cool didn't know about it.
Now, 9:30.
9:30, I might do a little surprise on you here. I probably would have watched at the time, and maybe today still, the second half of Law & Order.
Okay, I think that's respectable, because the only other option you really had at this time was Coach, which I absolutely loathe.
I didn't enjoy Coach as a child. It seemed much more grown up in it and didn't care.
In a bad way. Yeah. Have you ever seen Craig T. Nelson's stand-up?
No.
You're a lucky, lucky man.
Didn't know that he did.
His photo's up at the Comedy Store, I believe. He was a stand-up. I do not like Craig T. Nelson. I would have gone with on the Discovery Channel, one of my favorite shows, and I still love it, and I hunt down episodes to this day. It was an Australian show about new technology called Beyond Tomorrow.
Wow.
And I watched it every week. I absolutely loved it. This particular episode has two topics that they highlight. Crocodile breeding and robot-assisted surgery. Clearly better than Coach.
Absolutely.
All right. On to Wednesday. What do you got, 8 o'clock?
The cover story, Wonder Years.
Yeah, good move with Wonder Years. Quality show, very sad show. I remember distinctly crying at the last episode.
Oh, yeah, they really nailed it.
And this was between the sort of the end, towards the end of the show, but was still quality. This one, as the Vietnam War rages overseas, another war rages at home between Wayne and his dad over Wayne's laissez-faire study habits and lack of concern for his future.
Wow.
I am still to this day terrified of Dan Lauria. He is,
because of his dadliness on that show.
Yes, he was just so terrifying.
I agree. Here's the thing is, have you watched the show recently?
Oh yeah, I still rewatch it frequently.
Cuz I haven't seen it in a long time, but then I saw like at least a snippet of Fred Savage and Danica McKellar.
Right.
And it was towards the beginning of the run, and so they're so tiny.
They're so baby.
But
they're
they were probably, he's probably my age.
Right.
So, as I was watching it, I was like, people my age. And that's such a weird, the body dysmorphia that you have.
You never feel the age you actually are on TV. You always identify with people who are older than you.
And so now I watch it, and I'm like, wow, they're like babies.
They're really tiny, yeah. And they're like kissing, and it's a little bit uncomfortable.
Yeah.
But still handled well. It's sweetly done.
And related, I love Boy Meets World.
I like the first two seasons, and then it became a really bad sort of Friends ripoff.
It wasn't very good.
Awful. No, it still isn't.
But here's, a couple interesting things that I know that maybe not everyone knows about Boy Meets World. So it started, I think they were in sixth grade.
Right.
Then they went to high school, which they were like, oh, it's a big, it's a big school. So it's like middle school, high school. So 7 through 12.
Right.
So that second year, they're in seventh grade. Then there are two more years that are high school, and then they're seniors. So they skipped. They're like, okay.
They might have been very smart.
Yeah, but nobody knew. And then Minkus shows up again at graduation,
right.
Who hadn't been around since sixth grade.
Here's another fact that you may not know about Boy Meets World. The high school set was reused from Head of the Class, which had been canceled on ABC the year before Boy Meets World started. So
absolutely
it was a reused
set. Didn't know that.
Which I was the first person to notice, and I remember telling kids at school, I was like, it's the same high school set, and they were like, you're a nerd, I'm going to punch you in the stomach now.
And you're like, I'll have a podcast someday.
Yes. If you're a fan of the Savage Brothers, and I know you're a huge Howie Mandel fan, I recommend you watch the movie Little Monsters.
Oh, I remember that from being advertised in my comic books.
It's actually a pretty good, weird movie, and gets really dark at the end.
The other thing about Boy Meets World that that I liked was, do you remember there was a Halloween-y kind of episode with Jennifer Love Hewitt?
Yes, I do remember that
one. She played a character named Jennifer Love Pfefferman.
Yes.
She was dating Will Friedle at the time.
I love Jennifer Love Hewitt, I will add that.
And that episode, it was like a Scream parody.
Yes, yeah, that was a good, Boy Meets World did Halloween specials well, because the year before that was the one where Corey was going through puberty, but thought he was becoming a werewolf.
Yes.
Which we've all had that.
I remember when I remember my first pubic hair. And I actually thought I was under a fuzzy blanket, and so I thought it was a part of the blanket.
Right.
And I was like, oh, there's a hair, and I pulled it, and it hurt.
That would hurt. Yeah, that would absolutely hurt.
It hurt. And I was like, what? Why is this blanket hurting me?
I remember when I first went pubic, I was still seeing my pediatrician, they do the exam of your genitals. And I remember being really embarrassed because there was pubes down there, and we kind of locked eyes, and he was like, I'm really sorry. And
he's
I was like, yeah, I know.
I got into this to see no pubes.
Yes.
Ever.
I went bald.
Then when the last thing about Boy Meets World, which was not even on the on this slate.
Right. But, started the next year.
I remember, so, you know, that Corey and Topanga were in love since sixth grade.
Right.
And stayed, like, you know, true love. You know, maybe they...
And had a baby now from Girl Meets World.
Exactly. But so they never... it was so crazy because before they were married, we never knew them to... I think they decided not to have sex.
Right. I remember that plot.
And then... when they got married, then all of a sudden now they're like basically like a married couple from like, you know, the Donna Reed show.
Right, separate beds.
Yeah, and but like now the old ball and chain, right. You know, turned into
Peg Bundy.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
And if you had asked me what the deal is, I would have said, Mike, it's different when it's your wife.
It is. You don't have sex before you have a wife, and then you don't have sex after you have
a wife. Exactly,
exactly. ABC Family TV.
Right. So I love the Wonder Years. And then as a side note, a guy I used to work with, I used to be the assistant in a sales department, his cousin played the mom on the Wonder Years.
Oh.
And he went into the hospital for gallbladder surgery or something. And as an aside, they were passing around a card for him. And I was reading what people wrote, and someone wrote, "That's what you get, pig." And so I went to this guy and I was like, oh, do you guys have, is this like a joke you guys have together? And the guy goes, nope. So this guy went to the hospital and he's like, that's what you get, pig. And then signed his name, which is excellent.
But why did he do that?
He just didn't like the guy. He was like, oh, he's in the hospital. Let me see that card.
Good.
Yeah. But while he was in the hospital, when he got back, the mom from the Wonder Years called. And I answered the phones because I was the assistant, and I almost went to tears when I heard her voice on the phone.
Oh, my God.
I was very shocked at my reaction. So I although I love The Wonder Years, I would have gone with Unsolved Mysteries.
Okay.
Would have gone with Unsolved Mysteries. It terrified me, but I watched it every week. This particular episode had an update on a Tennessee man's reunion with members of a family to whom he gave refuge during the Depression. Boring. Also, repeat reports on a Georgia man's search for his brother following a 1990 boating accident. Also boring. And the mystery of a caretaker who squandered the riches of an elderly widow. No ghosts, no UFOs. Normally I would have watched it, but I think this night I would have gone Wonder Years. However, here is the X factor. For the two seasons this show was on, I loved it. Davis Rules, which was Randy Quaid, Bonnie Hunt, and Will, and oh my God, I'm Jonathan Winters.
Whew. You love Bonnie Hunt.
I love Bonnie Hunt so much. She's like my all-time hero.
I kind of remember Davis Rules being a thing.
She was only added the second season, but it was great. Her and Jonathan Winters together could watch it all day.
I understand. I never watched Unsolved Mysteries, and I'm fine with that.
You don't feel like you missed out on anything?
I don't think so. I mean, if I missed out on anything, it is a mystery that will never be solved.
Right. Maybe we could bring the show back to solve this mystery. So, 8:30, what'd you go with?
I stuck with... I watched Growing Pains all the time.
I loved Growing Pains. It was a great show. This, also the final season of Growing Pains. The finale of Growing Pains upset me so much I had to stay home sick from school for 2 days.
I don't remember what happened. Why did it...
Maggie got
died?
Transferred...
Yeah.
Everyone died.
Yeah.
And horrifically. Maggie got transferred to D.C., mm-hmm. So they moved out of the house.
Where did they live?
In Long Island.
Okay.
And so the final shot, it's in, they sit on the floor, they're eating pizza for the last time in a furnitureless Seaver home. They leave, you think it's over, she comes back in and realizes she forgot a photo of the family on the mantle, picks up the photo, and written on the brick behind it is, Mike was here. She touches it, cries, cut to black.
Wow.
Niagara Falls from my eyes. I was very upset, very upset.
I wish I had a family that
I
cared about.
Yeah, I wish
like
I had
that.
A family. I wish that Maggie Malone was my mom. I loved that show. Although I think a good move would have been here, and I enjoyed this show as well, on CBS, Brooklyn Bridge was on.
I also, yeah, I might have taped one, watched the other.
Because what a great sort of TV double feature of the Wonder Years and Brooklyn Bridge.
Oh, yeah.
Very suburban and the urban of the same rough time period.
Can't argue with you.
But Growing Pains, this episode's not great. It was in the Chrissy year. When Chrissy comes home with head lice, it's the Seaver men who play nursemaid while Maggie and Carol lounge at a resort hotel fending off men.
Sure.
This is like most shows that go on too long. It was a little sillier than need be. What'd you go with? 9 o'clock.
I stuck with Doogie Howser.
Hated Doogie Howser.
Okay.
I hate Neil Patrick Harris.
Still?
Still. I hate him more than I hated him then.
Wow.
Because he's the guy...
I mean, he was a kid then.
He was a kid then, but he just was a smug prick.
Do you think he's a smug prick now?
I feel like he's a smug prick. And people are always like, but he's so funny and he sings and...
And I think he's nice.
Have you met him?
No.
Yeah, I feel like if you met him, you'd be like, what a smug prick.
I mean, the thing that brought him, you know, sort of from childhood into adulthood was playing the part of a smug prick on in the, you know, the Harold and Kumar movies.
Right.
Like, so, and that's the kind of thing that you don't do. Like, that if you are an asshole, like, you don't generally get talked into pretending to be the kind of asshole that you are.
You probably do, because if you're an asshole, you probably don't think you're an asshole.
That's possible.
So if someone says, "Will you play an asshole in this?" You'd be like, A, I can, because I'm the best, and I can act in anything. And B, yeah, because no one, clearly this is a parody of me.
I think that it actually, I mean, yeah, I don't know him in real life.
Neither do I. Yeah. I'm just assuming here. I don't hate him as much as I hate Jason Hervey.
Okay.
He might be a nice guy. I'd sit down with him and have a meal. And if he could win me over, hey, fair enough.
That's the thing. I mean, like, with a Jason Hervey, obviously, that part, he was such a horrible, like...
But just looking at his face, I just want to punch it.
But so that's why, if in real life, like, here's the thing. Do you know Walton Goggins?
No.
Walton Goggins played on The Shield, like, sort of the right-hand man of Michael Chiklis.
Okay.
And then now is on a show that I love, Justified.
Okay.
And he is sort of like the arch nemesis, but he's like, you know,
he's
there's
a bad guy.
There's the cop and the criminal that grew up together.
Right.
So there's like a friendly nostalgia
Which happens.
Between them. Oh, yeah, absolutely.
A mutual respect.
Oh, yeah. And so Walton Goggins on Shield, like, annoyed me so much. I'm like, look at his face. I don't like it.
Right.
And now and when I see him anywhere else on Justified, he's a completely different character. I'm like, oh, wow. I like his face. I think he's just
a good actor.
He's a great actor.
But let me tell you about Jason Hervey, sure. First of all. He was in so many ads as a kid, really annoying. Played a dickhead in the Monster Squad, was a dickhead on the Wonder Years, later went on to marry a porno star and run some kind of sports management company.
So, fair enough. Okay.
I mean, I'm just going with the facts here.
I got you. Well, nothing like that. You can't do that for Neil Patrick Harris.
I'd sit down with Neil Patrick Harris and try to like him. Hervey, I wouldn't even accept the invitation. So if Jason Hervey is listening, don't bother to send
Understood.
Me an email. All right. So I wouldn't have gone with Doogie Howser. I was not a fan of Doogie Howser at all. I think I would have gone with Get Smart on Nickelodeon.
Oh,
love
sure.
Get Smart. Would have gone with that show.
I enjoyed that as well.
9:30. What do you got?
Honestly, this one I didn't really have much. I didn't watch anything but Love, but I would.
You would have, if you had to watch, then you would have go with it.
Because that was Richard Lewis, right?
Richard Lewis, Jamie Lee Curtis, and one of my favorite people, Ann Magnuson, who is amazing.
I mean, to this day, like, I enjoy watching Richard Lewis.
It was an okay show.
Yeah.
It was an okay show. It's not great, but it wasn't bad. It's not a bad move. You really didn't have any other choices. The only other things that were on was MTV Sports, a rerun of the Dick Van Dyke Show.
Yeah.
Anything but Love would have been the move. On to Thursday. This one's usually a slam dunk for most people. They all mostly say the same thing. Let's see if Mike Kaplan, you are in that camp. What do you got? 8:00.
I mean, The Simpsons, it was my number one, though obviously I would have also watched Cosby.
So you would have taped one, watched the other.
Yes.
Yeah, The Simpsons, this was when The Simpsons were still on Thursday nights. Thank God they moved to Sundays, because man, was that a difficult call for most of us at that time.
Absolutely.
Cosby also sort of at the end of its run by this point, so I definitely could have easily passed up Cosby and gone with The Simpsons with the new kid in town there. The Cosby episode this week, not that great. The Simpsons episode this week, Bart becomes a strict law enforcer and Lisa is a lawbreaker aptitude tests point them in the opposite direction.
Oh, so good.
That's a classic episode. So I think that's easily the move that night. 8:30, what do you got?
I stuck with Drexel's Class.
Ooh. Ooh. The third failed Dabney Coleman show.
Yep.
After Buffalo Bill, the Slap Maxwell story, and Drexel's Class.
This is funny because this is the first I ever saw Dabney Coleman, but all, you know, that name enough. Like, I was like, oh, it seems like I know this guy.
Yeah. I mean, I love Dabney Coleman, but Drexel's Class was just like a bad head of the class, which is saying a lot.
Sure.
I would have gone with Different World. Absolutely loved it.
I guess I didn't really care as much about A Different World. I definitely watched it sometimes.
So you had no aspirations to go to a fictional black college?
I didn't. Yep. I mean, in real life I did, but in...
Right, because that's
a fictional one.
That's how you ended up at a fictional black college.
Exactly.
Called Boston University.
So.
And this episode has Garrett Graham in it, who I'm a huge fan of Used Cars fame, Phantom of the Paradise.
Well, I'm happy to, you know, buck the trend.
We can agree to disagree on this one. 9 p.m., what do you got?
I would certainly watch Cheers to this day. Cheers, 100%.
Right.
But that's another show, like Night Court, that I didn't start watching until... Like,
it was a rerun show.
I think I probably watched, like, the season the series finale.
Everybody watched it, especially around here, which, yeah. Mike, you didn't grow up around here, but, man, was that a big deal.
It was... I remember watching it, and, like, you know, even though I didn't have the history that, you know, would back up the emotions that were packed in it.
Right.
But so I was like, oh, yeah, this is... That was a show that, while it was on, like, you know, I remember watching, like, Roseanne with my family and then not watching Cheers. Like, right. They were probably watching
Cheers. Cheers always seemed a little older. Like, Roseanne, yeah. At least you could sort of get in with the kids. Yeah, and Cheers was about old people in a bar.
Yeah, so, but I definitely, when I started watching it in high school, I was like, oh, this is amazing. Like, you know, Cliff
it's great.
Jeopardy and, you know.
It's a great show.
Super funny.
The thing that really messed with me with Cheers is, obviously, I grew up in Boston. Cheers is set in Boston, and the set was based on the Bullfinch Pub, which most people know. That was near my uncle's work, and he would take me there, and I didn't really know that it wasn't Cheers.
Mm.
I mean, I was probably five.
Sure.
And I was always like, where is Sam? Why isn't Sam working? And he'd make me ask, and they'd all laugh at me. And then my uncle would be like, oh, it's his day off. And I didn't figure out till about 3 years after that wasn't, they didn't actually work there.
So he was pranking you, but...
I got pranked, yeah.
You were not it's not your fault. You're a child.
Yeah, I don't know that...
Your brain is not fully formed.
Yeah, it's a TV show that looks exactly like the place, is set in the place.
Yeah. And you thought it was a reality
exactly.
show.
Exactly. I didn't know.
But also on at that time was 90210, which at the time I was like, 90210, no.
Me too.
I've been waiting to say that. I actually did start watching 90210 in college when, from Saved by the Bell.
Oh, yeah, Tiffany Amber Thiessen.
When she joined, I was like, maybe I've been wrong to not watch this show.
Because you were a Saved by the Bell fan?
I definitely liked Saved by the Bell. Yeah. And I thought she was, at the time, I was like, she is cute.
She still is.
And now I will watch it.
Yeah. I hated Beverly Hills 90210, mostly because I hated it. But also, when it first started, it aired against The Flash. Thursday nights, it was watch The Flash or Beverly Hills 90210. I was strongly in The Flash camp, and when The Flash got canceled, I wouldn't watch it just out of principle. And as you know, I'm mostly motivated by spite.
Your principles.
Yes.
You're a man of principle.
This episode of Beverly Hills 90210, Donna and David save a party from being a social disaster, but they're powerless against an accident that ends the party and a life.
Oh, yeah. That must have been the kid who was spinning a gun around while high.
Yep, I remember that one. I remember the promos for that one, but not watching it. And I remember laughing because it was so hilarious. And girls coming into school the next day being legitimately upset about what happened.
Oh, man.
But hey, you know what? I don't care. not my favorite show. So the final night this week, Friday night.
Hold on. After Cheers was Wings.
Oh, Wings. Yes. I'm sorry. I forgot that you didn't go with 90210 the hour show. Wings is one of my all-time favorites.
Wonderful. That now you're looking like, oh, all those people are successful.
Great show. Which brother did you prefer? Everyone preferred one of them.
Oh, Tim Daly.
Tim Daly.
Yeah.
You and I was a
Tim Daly guy.
Tim Daly. I love Tim Daly. He's great in Diner, and he was great as Superman's voice in the animated Superman series from the 90s.
Today, I would probably... I mean, I feel like Steven Weber has done more things that I have watched since
I'm sure, including the remake of The Shining.
I don't know that I watched that, but I do remember him from that. I remember him on... Was it an Aaron Sorkin show? Was he on he was on the Saturday Night Live Sunset Strip?
Sunset Strip.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He was like the Amanda Peet's boss.
Mm-hmm. He's funny. I like Steven Weber.
He was on an episode of Party Down that was great.
Oh, yes. I remember that one.
He made his eye, I guess it was makeup maybe, but his eye was like leaky or like sort of saggy. He played like, you know, a European mobster of some kind.
He was just that good at acting. He was able to sag his eye.
He was great.
I could see him being terrifying if he chose to be.
Yeah.
Not Wonder Years dad terrifying, but
no,
up
I
there.
Understand. So, final day.
Friday night, the final day, 8 o'clock. What'd you go with?
I was as a child, Family Matters 100%.
Yeah, I mean, I agree. I used to watch Family Matters. I was a Perfect Strangers fan. It was a spinoff of Perfect Strangers. But by 92, it started to get way too Urkel-y for my tastes.
Mm-hmm.
This particular episode, strangely, is not very Urkel heavy. Rachel reluctantly hires a loudmouth, pushy Harriet to help at the restaurant, and Urkel bets the ranch on Carl's cutthroat poker game at home with the guys. So Urkel's the B story here, a little more tolerable. but what an annoying character.
Yes.
Were you an Urkel fan, or you just watched it to watch it?
I mostly watched it to watch it, but I definitely, I liked Urkel.
See, I probably would have gone, because as I said, Urkel was just annoyed me too much at this point, so I think I probably would have gone with America's Most Wanted.
Yeah, that was, like Unsolved Mysteries, never watched, like Cops, never watched.
I enjoyed that sort of gritty crime thing, and I also enjoyed John, what's his name, the guy who hosted America's Most Wanted.
Let's bring that back.
I enjoyed his badassery.
Sure.
Yeah. America's Funniest Most Wanted really should be a thing. And also I should mention on TBS at 7:05, which is TBS time, which they've since gotten rid of, but really should bring back. At 8 o'clock, the movie One Dark Night was on, which is a fantastic movie.
Don't know it.
Great horror movie from 1983. Meg Tilly's in it. Elizabeth Daly's in it. Adam West is in it. Yeah. It's about an evil undead magician in Los Angeles.
I would enjoy it.
It's a cool movie. You can borrow it if you like. You might enjoy it now. Great commentary on the DVD, by the way.
The 7:05 thing, like, I remember being so... they're just trying to trick me into... Like, oh, I guess I gotta just keep watching this channel.
It was brilliant.
I'm stuck on it.
It was a brilliant move, because if you watched one thing on TBS, you had to watch it all day, because it ended by the time everything else had already started, and you can't jump in 5 minutes into a show.
They were ridiculous.
That is just... That's a brilliant move. I can't think of a better TV programming move. Like, I think Ted Turner probably did the laugh you just did when he thought of it. Like, he was just he was in a tub, and he was just like, the 05s.
Wow.
Yeah. Yes, TBS time. So 8:30, what do you got?
I stuck with Step by Step.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I've never met anyone who acknowledges that this show was good, but many people watched it.
Oh, yeah. They put it at the right place, behind a show that everybody watched. And
awful.
I only remember the name of one person, Cody.
Everyone liked Cody.
He drank milk right from the gallon jug.
Yes. Sasha Mitchell was the actor's name.
Yeah.
He was...
Real-life wife beater?
Real-life wife beater. That's... Also, martial arts expert.
Oh, okay.
He was in Kickboxer 3 and 4.
You don't want both of those things.
No. Well, maybe you do. If you're the guy, you'd be really good at it.
I mean, you don't want one of those things.
Yeah. One of them's good, one of them's bad. In conjunction makes the other thing worse.
Yeah.
He was in that sort of way too late in the game surfer dude, like 4 years after Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure.
Yeah.
Very annoying.
He was just like the, you know, Joey from Blossom character, or the Joey from Friends character.
Way worse, worse.
Just a dummy that lived with them.
Because the show was poorly written, it was far too silly, and the only likable character in the whole show was Stacey Keenan.
I do remember, and was she the daughter on My Two Dads?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Great show.
Great show.
Yeah.
Yeah. I couldn't stomach Step by Step. It was also just so sleazy. There was a lot of parent sex in that show.
Huh. So it's Patrick Duffy and Suzanne Summers.
Suzanne Summers, yeah.
Which, I don't remember any plots. I don't remember any episodes of Step by Step.
Yeah, that's good. You've probably blocked them out in order to be a fulfilled human being.
I remember the theme song was over there. They were at an amusement park.
Step by step.
Day by day.
And day by day.
And they were on a... And I didn't honestly...
Second time around.
I only realized as an adult that it was named that because they were step families.
Exactly, yeah.
Didn't know it at the
How
time.
Ironic that Mike Kaplan, the king of puns, did not put two and two together that Step by Step was a step family.
Had no idea.
Wow. Maybe here's...
I was like, why is it called that? Oh, well, it doesn't matter.
I'm just going to throw this psychological theory out there and see if you're on board with it. But do you think... Your entire comedy career is an attempt to pursue the satisfaction that you missed out on by missing that pun. Are you trying to make a wrong right by being a pun-heavy comedian to try and make that missing right?
That's a great theory, and I can't acknowledge that that is even possible.
Fine. Yeah. I think I've broke ground. I'm gonna say that I'm correct here. So you went with Step by Step. I would have gone with the rerun of The Real World. It was the first season here.
Ooh, okay.
It was the New York season, which is great TV.
Today, I absolutely would. Yeah, I didn't watch it at the time. But yeah, certainly if you were to say, Mike, this is on or that's on, I would never watch Step by Step again today.
I'm glad that you said that.
Yeah, oh yeah.
Yeah. So 9 p.m. I think there's only one move here, and I think that you probably went with it. What do you got?
I'm still watching Dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs. Yeah. Fantastic.
Yeah.
Really great show.
My favorite, I certainly remember parts of it. There was one, Robbie, the teenage son, says to his dad, Dad, this year's like 59 million BC, but next year is like 58 million.
Right.
Why are we counting backwards?
Yes, it was very smart. That show is so subversive and left-wing. I feel like that show is exclusively responsible for a generation of liberal people. Because it was all like, aren't humans the worst? We ruined everything. And it was on an air. It was between Step by Step.
I mean,
what a difference. I feel like anyone that watched Step by Step and then watched Dinosaurs would just be like, what the hell did I just watch before this? Like, it would just wake you up from that fog about how awful Step by Step was.
Definitely.
Also, probably one of the darkest final episodes of all time.
Where, because they all went extinct?
They all die. They all freeze to death.
Huh.
They all freeze to death. The last shot is them freezing to death. And it's like, you should have known.
That's what happened.
Yeah, I feel like they should have just had the producers of the show just cut to them and go, you should have known the whole time.
It's great that they let them do that.
It was amazing. Amazing. Dinosaurs, great show, still great, highly recommend it. I definitely would have gone with that, but I will say that a favorite was on up against it, which was the show Sightings, which was like a sleazier, dumber version of Unsolved Mysteries.
Fair enough.
It was as if someone went, I like Unsolved Mysteries, but I only like the things about werewolves and UFOs, and they said, let's do a whole show of that.
Fair enough.
So what do you go with at 9:30?
I have nothing. I don't remember Baby Talk.
Baby Talk was a ripoff of Look Who's Talking. It was essentially the same show.
Then I probably would have watched that.
It got completely retooled after the first season. The first season had Julia Duffy from Newhart.
Okay.
She played the mom, and Tony Danza did the voice of the baby instead of Bruce Willis. Julia Duffy quit the show. It wasn't working for her. They retooled it the next season, brought in another woman and Scott Baio. For the second season. Surprisingly, not a success.
Ah.
This was the second season of Baby Talk. Awful show. Here's the plot. Maggie and James squabbles provide ample grist. Grist is not a word you see very often.
No. Wait, are we about to see mill? Because you never see it without mill.
Yes. Ample grist for the party guest's mill. when they help Doris entertain her therapist boyfriend and his colleagues. We're learning a lot of vocabulary in this, but other than that, terrible. You had the show Hidden Video, which previously was known as Totally Hidden Video on Fox, which was a prank show.
And now they're like, hey, guys, we're not actually totally hiding
this video.
It's not
totally hidden.
So let's get rid of that totally.
We got sued about the totally. But my move would have been on USA Network, Swamp Thing.
Okay, I did see that there.
Do not bring your evil here.
Never. Is it based on the DC comic?
Yes. It was much more, it was very low budget, so it wasn't very well done. But
live
it
was action.
Live action. Still starred Dick Durack from the films. Much more authentic and adhered to the comics than the films.
Oh, very nice.
Yeah. It was sort of a dark horror show. And this one, Teresa's friends are trapped in an invisible stealth shield created by Dr. Arcane. I'll admit, doesn't sound very good. But was definitely a better show than Baby Talk.
Yeah, so I would do that now with full disclosure, with full information.
Full disclosure and full exposure. Also, I should mention that it was Friday night, so USA Network, I would have just stuck on USA after watching Swamp Thing. And at 11, it was USA Up All Night,
which was
their titty movie show. And just to get it out there, the movie that night, Sizzle Beach, USA, starring Kevin Costner.
Great.
And they give it 1 star. I'm surprised by that. I feel like Sizzle Beach USA should at least warrant 2 stars.
A rarity.
Clearly Kevin Costner's finest role. Let me read the synopsis of Sizzle Beach USA, Mike. So you've never seen Sizzle Beach USA?
I've not.
Let's see.
It's got USA in the title as well?
It's called Sizzle Beach USA. That's the name
and
of the show.
And it's on the channel USA.
Exactly.
Got it.
Exactly. So they just say, horny beachgoers in Malibu. Starring Kevin Costner. I think that's well worth watching.
Probably they gave it 1 star because they're like, I don't want to see a movie that's all just horny Kevin Costners.
I always like to think that Field of Dreams is sort of an unofficial sequel to Sizzle Beach USA. It's where that guy ended up.
Get away from the beach.
So, Mike, we're done with the week. And finally, to end, TV Guide is not just a guide.
Nope.
TV Guide has opinions. Mm-hmm. It cheers and it jeers.
I understand.
So I'd like to read you the cheers and the jeers from this week and see if you agree or disagree.
Agree or disagree with cheers and jeers.
Yes, exactly. We'll shorten the title, make it a little snappier at some point.
Agreers and disagreers.
Agreers. So first, we have a cheers. Good way to start it off. To Saturday Night Live's unsung comic, Phil Hartman. And then it basically just talks about how great he is.
Which, it's interesting that there was a time when he was unsung.
He's
sung, and rightly so, of course, agree.
They basically say, you know, Mike Myers, Dana Carvey, Julia Sweeney, and Rob Schneider get all the credit.
Oh, but, that's amazing to see a time when Rob Schneider got more credit than Phil Hartman.
But they're saying Phil Hartman, he's the best. We both have to agree with
100%.
That. 100%. Jeers to G.I. Joe for being ecologically uninformed. In a recent episode titled The No-Zone Conspiracy, Deke Enterprises cartoon commandos blamed aerosols for the continuing destruction of the Earth's all-important ozone layer, which protects us from the sun's dangerous ultraviolet radiation. In truth, ozone-destroying chlorofluorocarbons, or CFCs, have been banned from aerosols in the U.S. since 1978, and most of the rest of the world since the mid-80s, with the exception of certain medical products such as asthma inhalers. Sorry, Joe, but it just ain't so.
Wow.
So a continuity error on a G.I. Joe episode warranted a jeer.
Does G.I. Joe, it took place in the modern world...
No, they had laser cannons. It wasn't a realistic show.
I disagree with this jeer.
Yeah, people had heads made out of metal on the show. I also disagree with this jeer.
Yeah, I mean, I guess... that's the weird thing. I've been talking about this lately, like... Because sometimes you have a fictional world where, obviously, most of the laws of physics exist.
Yeah, dinosaurs.
Like, we agree, that's true. Or, like, this is a real-life famous person also exists in that world. Like, The Tonight Show with Jay Leno is a thing in this universe.
Right.
But also, there's fictional...
Who, ironically, is responsible for the ozone destruction,
exactly.
Jay Leno.
Exactly. I understand where they're coming from. Like, I don't know exactly what their motivation is to be like, hey... Like, maybe the aerosol lobby was like, TV Guide.
Hey, we fixed this.
Get on this. Yeah. Stop besmirching.
I feel like this is sort of a precursor to every internet posting I read now. That sort of has that vibe. We have one more jeer.
Great.
Cheers to NBC political correspondent Lisa Myers for her astute and clever coverage of Campaign 92.
I don't have any...
It's indifferent on that one.
Really neutral.
Yeah. And finally, jeers to the U.S. House of Representatives for recently barring cable channel C-SPAN from televising both a Rules Committee hearing on 1992 budget cutbacks and a cable regulation markup session.
I don't really hear all that, but I'm sure that I agree with jeering Congress.
Yes, I also agree, speaking of Jay Leno. Jeer Congress, Mike Kaplan, I think we got some good work done here today.
Thanks for having me.
You're welcome. Thanks for being on the TV Guidance Counselor. And that was it. There you go. That was the very first episode of TV Guidance Counselor. Hopefully you made it all the way to the end here. Thank you so much for listening or downloading or however you obtained this podcast. Thanks to my guest, Mike Kaplan. Thanks to Sean Sullivan, as always. You can find Mike at MikeKaplan.com. You should definitely go see him when he comes to your town, and you should listen to his podcast, Hang Out With Me, which I have appeared on. Also, I think you guys got a real scoop here. We did get the secret origin of Mike Kaplan. Who knew that it was step-by-step related. I still stand by that was it. Secret Origins, Mike Kaplan, that's what you had there. So, check back in next Wednesday. We'll have an all-new episode. Thank you so much. This has been TV Guidance Counselor. I am Ken Reed. Thank you. My brain.